Hello, 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 and welcome back to another Chab Dog Sports Talk Show live from our studios here in Hermosa Beach, California. It's the Chab Dog Sports Talk Show where, well, myself and our co-hosts on the Discord channel, we're going to talk sports. We're going to talk, go through football, eight games here in week 17, and this is the what I found in week 17. In fact, let me just play a quick song here, in case you haven't heard this before.
I learned
the truth, week 17, that love was meant for Brock Purdy. Superbowls I never knew. The Monday night charades of you. Oh, Barry Sanders retired. Here we go. The Super Bowls I never knew. The Monday night charades of youth were spent on one more parlay. Week 17 I learned the truth.
And those of us with ravaged bets, lacking in winning ways, desperately betting cards, inventing bookies on the phone. Who called to say you won today, and murmured Rams obscenities. It isn't about Stafford's injuries. Week 17.
Anyway.
Wow, very creative.
You kids ever hear that song before?
No.
Yeah. God bless you, Dorothy. Yeah, I told my friends that you kids would not know who this Janice and who this song is or what this whole wordplay was all about. Abe, have you ever heard that song before?
You know, I don't know. It sounds familiar. It sounds like it would have been in a movie somewhere.
Aaron, have you ever heard that song before by Janice Ian? From 1974.
Nothing. No thank way.
You. Thank you. Thank you. My friend here in the green room was certain that one of you, if not all of you, would have heard this somewhere before. So it's just another you know what happens when early Gen X is trying to show later Gen X's and Gen Z's and millennials the ropes here. But anyway, welcome back to the Chab Dog Sports Talk Show. We're brought to you by the law offices. Yeah, the green room feels older today. We all feel a day older. The show is brought to you by the law offices of Brandon S. Chabner, where Brandon Chabner specializes in corporate law. You want to form your LLC, you want to do transactions between corporations, you want him covering your paper. And I am his handy legal aide who helps him with estate and trust business. And if you want to get a really good family trust, living trust, you want to understand what these things are and how they work for you and how spending a little bit with us will save you and your family tens of thousands, maybe even a lot more than that in the future. Yeah, come to see us. You're going to have to deal with somebody. The law offices at Brandon S. Chabner. But today we're here to talk sports. We're here to talk about week 17. In week 17, we learn the truth. There we are. Chab Dog upper right. Bang, right there. So we're going to introduce our co-host here today. In the upper left-hand corner is Aaron. Aaron, the Penn State alum from New Jersey. And he's a big Giants fan, and that's you're wearing your Giants colors today. And then below him in a blur, that's A. Miranda. All fuzzy. Maybe he's peeing for the D, perhaps. Oh, there he is. And then to his right is Dorothy D. And we'll start with Dorothy D., who's on a ship anchored off of Catalina Island. And she'd rather be on the show right now because it's such a long lineup. In fact, there's somebody else there waiting to... There's a big line to get off the boat, right?
Huge. Like, wrapped around the entire floor. The JP was like, oh, hell no. And he's never been on Catalina. I've been here several times. I can stay on the ship. That'd be fine with me.
Yeah, all the time I lived here, that's one thing I haven't done. I haven't gone to Catalina yet. Gotta get around to that one of these days.
Really?
I know.
Man,
maybe I'll take a date there sometime. Okay, right, we got lots of exciting stuff to cover today. We're going to dive into football here in a moment, but we do want to talk a bit about the bowl games that have occurred and the Pop-Tart Bowl. I got to make a mention of the Pop-Tart Bowl because that was pretty novelty. You know, the people who did the advertising company there should actually be hired by Bud Light to bring their brand back to life because these people are pretty smart. You know, I didn't even go buy a box of Pop-Tarts anymore. And some of the other bowl games going on, but without further ado, let's get to game one on our schedule. Oh, yeah, and before I mention go any further here, last show of the year, and we are missing Brandon Chabner, but I did have a Brandon Chabner sighting to show you. There he is, wearing a Celtics hat. And look, there's somebody wearing a mask. Like, do people still, is that still a thing? People wear masks? Look at that. There's somebody wearing a mask behind him in the stadium there. And then here's a shot of he and Ben. And they're watching a Celtics game here the other day. So.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
That's our namesake there, Brandon Chabner. He's back in Boston with his family hanging out. That's why he couldn't be with us today. But we did cover those pictures there. And Chab Dog, we'll see if we can cover the Steelers too, but I don't know about that. Let's get down to some football here. Game one. We've got the Patriots, 4-11 at the 9-6 Bills. They're traveling to Buffalo, 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. here in Hermosa Beach, California. The spread Buffalo is -13 in this contest. The Patriots won the first meeting back in October. But the Bills are 12-1 in home games against the division, and that one that they lost, it was that game back in October. So Buffalo's number one rated in the red zone offense. Yeah, 37 touchdowns and 55 trips. That's a 67% success rate. And, they're a win here gives them a 97.2% chance to be in the playoffs. A loss gives them a coin flip of getting into the playoffs. This is a must-win for Buffalo here. But they're 0-7 in their past seven games as a double-digit favorite. And last time I checked, they're down at 13. I'm reluctantly taking the Bills, but I want to hear what you folks have to say. Let's start with Aaron, because you're the closest to New York here, even though you're in New Jersey. So let's talk about the only team that's actually in New York State. Can the Bills cover 13 on this, Mr. York?
Yeah, I got the Bills covering. I think they are, like you said, they're motivated. They have to win, and they're going to hope Miami loses. But even if Miami does not lose, they have to win. And they are playing better lately. They're playing a lot better. It feels like since Joe Brady took over as offensive coordinator from Ken Dorsey, they have been more committed to exploiting a opponent's weakness. That's why they ran the ball so much against Dallas. They didn't feel the need to have Josh Allen do much of anything. They will just run you over if they have to, and it feels like their offense is more balanced, and it feels like they're playing some of their best football of the season lately. So I really like Buffalo to just blow them out, cover the 2-touchdown spread.
Mm-hmm. Dorothy, are you able to mute your microphone right now when you're not speaking? Because we're picking up some transient noise.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. Yep.
I think that's where it's coming from. Yeah, so I see you're taking the Bills. And let's talk to somebody who's taking the Patriots. Chabdog's taking the Patriots. Abe, you're taking the Patriots too.
I am taking the Patriots.
What's wrong with you
in this game? Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. When it comes to the Bills, first of all, the Bills have not been the Bills. So whatever you think the Bills are in your mind, that is not the Buffalo Bills. I mean, they've been really off this season. And, you know, they do come in with a 3-game winning streak into this game. But let me tell you, the only team they've been able to beat by 2 touchdowns was recently the Dallas Cowboys. But everybody else, they've either, you know, have kind of lost or have kept it, close. The Patriots, they really haven't lost by that much. I mean, you look at their game against the Denver, they lost by 3 points. Kansas City, tough team. They lost by only 10 points. Sorry, they beat Denver. They beat the Steelers 21-18. They lost the Chargers 6. Lost to the Giants by 3. So, I mean, there's at least a little fight in them. We're talking about Bill Belichick, right?
Mm-hmm.
Will the Bills come out victorious? Yeah. All they need is a win. That's what the Bills are looking for. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're not looking about the 14-point spread. So as long as the Bills are ahead at the end of the game, they're happy, you know. The Patriots, I think they're going to try to put in a little bit of a fight, show they have some heart in this game.
Okay, Dorothy, who are you taking this game and why?
We're taking the Bills.
Okay. So you're not picking up on this Patriot nonsense that Abe and Chabdog are on? Good.
Nope. They're fighting, I think, for the end here.
Yeah. I don't even know. Who's playing quarterback for the Patriots today? It's some bum anyway. So, exactly. That's another reason. Let's jump to game two. Game two, the 11-4 Dolphins at the 12-3 Raiders. 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. here on the Hermosa Beach, where the rain has stopped, but huge waves come crashing in. Baltimore is only a 3.5-point favorite at home, so it's kind of an even shot here. Showdown between the league's highest-scoring offense against the league's best defense. Ravens only give up 16 points per game, and the Dolphins typically score 29 points per game. I believe Jalen Waddell is not expected to play today. He's a scratch there, and he was a big part of their victory last week. But a Ravens victory here would give them the number one seed and home field advantage in the AFC South, so they've got a lot to play for there. But if the Dolphins win, they clinch the division, and they also have a shot at winning the AFC. They got a 55% shot at winning the AFC East title as well. But trouble is, the Dolphins have failed to cover three straight games as an underdog, as well as three straight as a road dog. And here they are, a road dog, and they've missed three straight. So the odds are not in favor for them. You know what? This is a simple one for me. Even though it's 3.5, it's 3.5. This is going to be a really close game. It's a simple one for me. The Ravens are going to win. Defense wins championships. They're better than Miami. But I think it's going to be a back and forth and a really close score like we had last night with Dallas, but not with the same kind of result that we missed by. It's going to be within the 3.5-point margin is what I'm trying to say. So I'm taking the Dolphins on a backdoor cover, but expecting the Ravens to win. Aaron, you're taking the Dolphins as well. Is that how you see it going down?
Yeah, it should be a close game. It should be an exciting game. You don't usually get these kind of exciting games with great teams and high stakes in that 1 o'clock window. So I'm really looking forward to it coming up in less than an hour here. And I think it's going to be a close game. And I did make this pick before I knew the injuries. Waddle and Mostert, the starting running back for Miami, was ruled out just recently. He was expected to play earlier in the week, but they still have Devon Achane. And I'm hoping that he can step up and make some big plays. And yeah, I think the line's the way it is because Baltimore just had that huge, huge win over San Francisco. But Miami, apart from that Titans snafu, they've been playing great football. So I'm just counting on it being an amazing, great game and taking the points in that scenario.
Dorothy, who are you guys taking on this one?
You know, here's the thing. I like the Ravens in this game. Okay, I'm picking the Ravens simply because, you know, the Dolphins are coming in here a little hurt. You know, I don't know. I feel like we don't have all the players here. You know, we're looking at a 3-point spread. So the Ravens, you know, are a strong team. They're a less hurt team. This is a home game for the Ravens. And I feel like there's just
go home and get your fucking shine box
of momentum swinging their way. Now, don't get me wrong; they both have beaten good teams, but again, you know, we're talking about a healthier squad on the Miami Dolphins, where the Ravens seem to have that advantage. So, I'm gonna go with the 12-3 Baltimore Ravens, who are on a 5-game winning streak, coming in here and making my brother lose his damn mind.
Okay. Dorothy, where are you at?
We're with Abe on this one. JP didn't give me an answer on this one. He just couldn't. And so he's like, what do you think? And I said, Ravens. They're at home. I agree with you. And they're both fighting for, you know, top-notch placement. I think Ravens. They're on a roll lately. Mm-hmm. Dolphins are too, but Go with the home team.
Okay. Well, then it turns out, Aaron, it's you and I and with the fish and Frank the Tank, and that's it. On to the next.
And Chab Dogs with the Ravens?
Yeah, Chab Dogs with the Ravens as well. Next, we'll move on to the Raiders, formerly of Oakland, now of Las Vegas. Formerly of Los Angeles, Oakland, and now Las Vegas. 7-8 at the 8-7 Colts. So playing in Indianapolis. 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. here on the West Coast. East Coast, West Coast. Indy is a 3.5-point home favorite here for some reason. But the Raiders under interim coach Antonio Pierce, you know, they've done pretty well. I think they won 4 or 5. Colts are hoping to have both their backs, Jonathan Taylor and Zach Moss, healthy and playing here today for the first time since November 26th. So they can get their running game going, and Raiders don't have that great a run defense. That could be really big for them. A win of the with the Colts gives them a 63% chance to make the playoffs. And if the Raiders win, you know, actually they still have a shot. They have a 34% chance to make the playoffs. And the Raiders are 6-1 against the spread in the last 7 games since hiring Pierce, and 4-1 against the spread in their past 5 games as an underdog. And today they are an underdog. I like the Raiders in this one, and we had some late news broke that one of the players for the Colts was arrested on Friday and taken into custody and is sitting in jail for some pretty egregious assault felony charges against family members or women or, you know, both. I have something going on. Maybe some hookers involved there. But it's just a bad situation. That's a distraction. And that's always tip of the eye. He ain't the only one on that team doing it. That kind of crap's going down. Give me the dirty, stinking Raiders. But, Abe, you're taking the Colts. Why don't you? You're from L.A. Why don't you take the Raiders?
You know, I gave up on the Raiders the moment they left L.A. But even when they were here in L.A., I still gave up on them. I wasn't really ever a Raiders fan, more of a Rams fan. Until they left, and then that was it. then I became a Packers fan.
That's
and
then the joke.
Then the Rams decided to come back, and then the Chargers decided to take a dump on San Diego and
bend
come to
here,
LA where nobody
again.
Wants them. Mm-hmm. Man, LA. This is why LA is the most jacked up football town, in the country. But here's the thing: Josh Jacobs from the Raiders. He is out. He is not playing today. But on the flip side, we have Zach Moss, who's also not playing today. So we've got no running game. You know, of course, we're going with Aidan O'Connell, I think, might be our quarterback for the Raiders.
Yeah.
Versus
good Irishman.
You know, versus Minshew, right? We're talking about a guy who's hasn't played all season, already has 7 interceptions. Seven interceptions.
11.
And I think in the last game, didn't he throw like a few interceptions, I think?
Yeah.
As
that was
well.
Last week. Not this week.
Yeah. So what we've got here is that we have a very sloppy Raiders team coming up to Indianapolis, which is a home game for them.
You Nuggies.
Know, yes, they beat the Chargers. They beat KC.
Now go home and get your fucking shine box.
But, you know, this is what I got. So, I it's a hard game to pick. This one's right. A tough one.
Yeah.
But I'm just going to go with a little more experience on the Colts side with this being a home
it's
game.
It's like when you eat too much meat. And it just gets hard to get all that thing out. Yeah, it's a hard one. Dorothy.
This is a hard one. A little bit of a hard one. It'll be a fun one, but a hard one.
Is this a hard turd for you? Yeah, I didn't see this one on your picks. Are you a hard turd Colt, or is it easy peasy Raiders with lots of roughage?
This one was a tough one for me as well, especially because I'm a Raider fan.
Wow.
I had to go to my bookie on this one because JP said Raiders.
Uh-oh.
I do like the Raiders better, so I will be cheering for them, but I think the Colts. My bookie says the Colts.
You're
agree.
Betting the Colts. Hold on. You're betting the Colts, right? She's nodding her head.
Yes.
Say yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Colts. Yes.
Excellent. She's nodding her head, but we still want to hear verbal confirmation. Always better. Game four. We got the Rams. 8-7 Rams against the 5-10 Giants. The game that Aaron's been waiting for all year. 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. here in Newport Beach, Hermosa Beach, California. Rams are a 4.5-point road favorite. That's not showing a lot of respect. But I think the problem is the Rams have this rookie player named Puka Nacua, wide receiver, and the Rams have also scored, using him, 28 points in the past 5 straight games. That's pretty heavy. So 28 points, 5 straight games against Tyrod Taylor. So he's pretty good back when he's in Buffalo. He's pretty good when he got to play unscripted. He's excellent, actually. He's a perfect improviser. But back to the Rams. They win, and they're 85% chance to make the playoffs. They lose, and it's a 22% chance. It's a massive spread. And the Rams have covered 5 straight games, the longest active streak in the NFL. I really have enjoyed riding the giant bandwagon and getting wins this season. But I'm afraid even at 4.5 points, it's one I can't do today. So I apologize to you in advance, Aaron. But tell me why I'm wrong.
No, you should apologize to yourself. The Giants are going to cover this spread. Giants have been a covering machine. So there's no conflict of interest with me. I'll just take them every week. And Tyrod Taylor last week, Giants lost to the Eagles. They fell behind. Their comeback was too little too late. They just fell behind by too much with Tommy DeVito under center. They bring back Tyrod Taylor, and Brian Daboll said it was to give the team a lift and or a spark, and it did give the team a spark. Amazing late touchdown throw to Darius Slayton to keep the Giants in that one and cover that spread, and it'll keep them in this one long enough to cover this spread. I am worried about Deontay Banks, the great rookie defensive back. He is out, and that is going to be a problem for the Giants, so they only put up some points to cover this spread. Mm-hmm. And I think they do that, especially with Wandell Robinson playing some good football, and Darren Waller is playing well with Tyrod Taylor. He's also getting healthier, so I'm hoping the Giants score enough points to do this. And with Taylor under center, and that's my guy, that's a quarterback on this team I have the most faith in, I think they will do that.
Well, this beckons the question. They had Tyrod Taylor the whole season. Why didn't they play him earlier?
So he was hurt when DeVito first came in, and then DeVito got rolling. He had that great game against the Packers. So,
okay.
So I don't blame him for trying to see what they had in DeVito, because, Tyrod Taylor, his upside is limited. He is a known entity.
Yes.
So, I mean, but really the Saints game was the only one. They won 3 straight with DeVito. They beat Washington, beat New England, beat Green Bay. So the only game that really hurt them was in New Orleans. Yep. They went down there in the Bayou, and DeVito got exposed. And then beginning the Eagles game, he continued to play poorly. So I think the New Orleans game is the only one I can point to where I can say, wow, Taylor might have made the difference in that one when he was healthy.
All right. Well, Dorothy, who are you taking here, the Rams or the Giants?
Rams.
Uh-oh.
Definitely taking the Rams. Just the Giants are. And the Rams are still fighting for a playoff position, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, yeah. So, Aaron, I'll tell you in advance here. Chab Dog and myself and Abe are all taking the Rams as well. So, you know where this puts you.
G-Man Island, baby.
That's right, baby. Get your ass on the Giants Island.
G-Man against the world. Against the world. Let's go. Let's get this
you
one outright.
You and Tommy Cutlets on the island.
Outright.
So, Abe, you're taking the Rams. Even though the Rams broke your heart and left L.A. and then came back, you're back on the Ram.
Look, I pick winners. I pick winners. You know, the fact that they left me in my childhood and scarred me for life, well, you know what? I just have to, you know, sacrifice and just pick winners. That's it.
Excellent. Excellent. All right. Well, let's.
Except last night, that I did not pick a winner in the Lions, even though I went with the chalk.
Well, let's take a moment to discuss that now that we've got the whole team here. Dorothy, that's a horrible way. Well, okay, it isn't a horrible way. I played football, and so when you can go tackle eligible, And then, but it's no, there's no, like, we're hiding this from anybody. You got to tell the ref or the side judge, and then they announce it to everybody, you know, blah, 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 everybody, you know, to the full fucking stadium, you know, the number whatever is eligible. And then you run the play, and sometimes they don't run right. it at all, but they do it as a psych. So the moment they came to the line and the quarterback didn't hear that, it was his fucking fault for throwing the ball because they knew it was going to get called back because the guy wasn't eligible because it wasn't announced he was eligible. Sorry. You know, don't blame the refs. Maybe the refs, he told the ref and the ref didn't make the announcement, but if you don't make the announcement, don't run the play. You know, you got to take, people got to take responsibility. Dorothy?
Oh, so you're.
Yeah. Is it the ref's fault
that he
didn't
golf
run that play? Yeah.
I think it's the ref's fault. Like, are you saying that Goff shouldn't have ran that play?
Yeah. He should have stopped and said, hey, this is why they didn't announce the tackle eligible. If you don't announce tackle eligible, you're going to get flagged every time. So he should have called the refs over and said, hey, that guy told you that we're running a play, tackle eligible. Why didn't you announce it?
Oh, okay. Goff should have gone over and been like, can you stop the game, though? Would that be a delay of game?
Not if it's a ref.
The problem is they might not have enough time to get that figured out after the a wrong announcement because they did not have any timeouts left.
Well,
so it would have helped if they were able to, I don't know, who needs to more clearly communicate that it was Decker they needed to be eligible, if it was the Lions or if it was the referee. There's also the issue they might have been trying to confuse the Cowboys by bringing in multiple players, and that's why number 70 was over there as well, because I think Detroit thought it would be too obvious if they just had Decker talking to the referee. So they kind of sent a couple decoys, and then maybe Decker said it, but he was the referee was looking somewhere else, and maybe that's where it got lost in translation.
But still, you can't pull a fast one when he announced to the whole stadium, you know, number 70 is eligible.
Yeah, I agree. And yeah, and if he announced it was 68, maybe the Cowboys cover that better, right? Because they did leave Decker open, but they also were under the impression that he was not an eligible receiver.
I mean, the Cowboys got smoked on that fake punt, which, like, the commentators we were listening to, because we don't listen to the fucking stooges that call the game. We put guys on YouTube. We're talking, saying, hey, this is a perfect play. Why is he punting here? He should be going for it on fourth down. And they said, he's probably going to fake it. And then the Cowboys just fell asleep, and they got that good fake. And there was the other play where CD Lamb dropped the ball out of the end zone. I hope they don't change that rule. I like that rule.
I love how everyone complains about that rule. It's been the rule forever. And then now that they have people of social media, they start complaining about it. But yeah, just hold on to the football. You got to protect the football. Everyone knows you got to protect the football. So
yeah.
I'm fine with it.
Oh yeah, totally. That was an exciting game. You know, one of the best. It was 7-3 for
Oh my gosh.
One of the most exciting 7-3 games.
Just kick it. Kick it.
I know. By the third time, just kick it.
Just kick the damn ball.
Is that stubbornness, Dorothy? Is that something about Michigan where people are so stubborn they're just going to stick their feet in?
I don't think necessarily, maybe a little bit. But very German people and we're stubborn, but
German.
I think Dan Campbell tries so hard to be different, and I think he should have at that third time get the message, like, just kick it, you know. Yes. First two times have not worked. It's showing you a sign. Just kick it and so let's start over.
Yeah, that was the universe giving him a sign. Absolutely. The universe is giving us a sign too.
That was one of the wildest things. I almost respect it, even though it was really dumb. But in his press conference after the game, they asked him, like, why did you stick with this 2-point after you backed up to the 7-yard line? And he just said, I told them before the drive, we're going to go down and score, and then do the 2-point conversion. And he just stood on that. And I felt like he was trying to keep a promise to his offensive guys. But I don't think anyone would blame him if he changed the plan after that penalty.
Well,
that turned out to be a bad decision.
By the third time, yeah. Oh, well. All right, let's jump to game 6. We got the game 6. Where's 6? The Saints. There we are. The 7-8 Saints at the 8-7 Buccaneers. 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. here on the West Coast. We got, it's dubbed the Battle of the South. Yeah, 7-8 versus 8-7. It's the Redneck Battle of the South. Tampa Bay is, however, on a 4-game winning streak. And they've won their past three meetings against the Saints, so they kind of own the Saints. And the Bucks, yeah, they win, and guess what? They get the third consecutive NFC South title and fourth straight playoff berth. And the Saints, what do they have going for them? Derek Carr. So now here's the trouble, though. The Buccaneers, so yeah, obviously we all want to jump high on the Buccaneers, but the Buccaneers are 1-6 outright against teams currently with winning records. The Saints are 7-8. That's not a winning record, so, huh. I still like the Bucks. I'll take the Bucks and take the danger here. Give me the Buccaneers minus 2.5.
Be dangerous. Yeah. I'm with you, Eric. I'm with you. Let's go with the Buccaneers on this one. It's a home game. You know, they just wanna beat the Saints and go to the playoffs.
Yep.
That's it. That's their strategy. The Saints, you know, they're, you know, I don't know. They're not there for me.
They're totally. Aaron, you're on the Bucks. Same thing.
Square bet of the day. Square bet. Have to do it. Why is this Bucks spread under 3 points? Doesn't make any sense. They've won four straight. They have covered in three of those. They just crushed the Jaguars. Maybe their best win of the season.
Yeah.
And yeah, why are they the better team? Why isn't this 3.5, 4, or 5 points? I don't know. Feels like a trap, but I am being a square and hoping it pays off. Maybe it'll be that easy. Maybe sometimes it is that easy. Buccaneers, let's go.
Dorothy. Are you taking the Bucks as well?
Buccaneers. Bucks, yep. Bucks as well.
Oh. Well, trouble is, Chab Dog's taking the Bucks too, which means and Chab Dog always gets the Saints wrong. So guess what? Maybe we should all flip to the Saints quickly here.
That's why it's square. No, I'm riding this square pick out. I'm committed to it. I know it. Right. If you know it's a trap, then you're ready for it. We're going to go in there. We're going to kick New Orleans' ass today.
Well, speaking of traps, let's get to our game six. The 8-7 Bengals, another 8-7 team against the 9-6 Chiefs. Only one win separates these two teams here. This is our afternoon game. This is the national game for everybody except in the L.A. market who's going to get to watch some bullshit game here. 4:25 p.m. Eastern, 1:25 p.m. here locally. Yeah, unless you got the ticket, you ain't watching this, but I have access to it, so I'll be seeing it. In Kansas City, surprisingly, 7-point favorite, but they are playing at home. Now, here's a very telling stat. If the game is anything like the Chiefs and Bengals meetings from recent seasons, it's going to come down to the end. There are four games from the past 2 years, two in the regular season and two in the AFC Championship games, have been decided by exactly 3 points. If it's a similar scenario today, it has to favor the Bengals because the Chiefs have been unable to rally for a win in the fourth quarter the entire season. So that stat alone sways me. However, the Chiefs are 10-18 against the spread in their past 28 games when laying at least a touchdown. And they're at least a touchdown here today. And Kansas City, yeah, if they win, they're 92% chance to win the playoffs and win the division. But even if they lose, yeah, 92.8% chance for the playoffs, but if they lose today, it's still 90.8% if they lose. So it's not a huge game for Kansas City that way. Not to say that anybody wants to lose, but Kansas City just hasn't been operating right, and we all have eyes, and we can all see it ourselves. I'm taking the Bengals here. I think I don't know whether it's a backdoor, I don't know whether it's an outright, but I'm taking the Bengals here. Chab Dog's also taking the Bengals. But Aaron, you're taking the Chiefs. What's up?
Yeah, don't count out the Chiefs. That's my whole thing. Hopefully people and Vegas Vegas not overreacting. Hopefully everyone else overreacting to their horrible, horrible performance on Christmas against the Raiders, and they come out here and they play much better. It is a little suspicious. I'm going the opposite of the Tampa Bay game. I'm trying to be sharp. I'm trying to figure out what Vegas is doing. And the Bengals are also coming off poor performance. They got killed at Pittsburgh.
Massacred.
Allowing 34 points to the Steelers. So they're not playing their best football either. I'm thinking the Chiefs have done this over the years where every time you count them out, they show you why they're the Chiefs and why they're a Super Bowl contender every year. And I'm thinking they're going to do that this week to the team that they have motivation to beat, because this is the team that has, or it did end their season 2 years ago. They overcame them last year, but
gave them the most trouble.
They're kind of a rival, basically, kind of a rival outside the division, the Bengals. So I think Kansas City, they have something to prove that they're not a bum team like they were last week, and they are going to get redemption and win big today.
Abe, you're on the Chiefs today.
Yes, you know, I am on the Kansas City Chiefs on this game against the Bengals, who are, again, without their star quarterback. All right, we also need to keep in mind that Ja'Marr Chase is still questionable for this game on the Bengals side. So the Bengals here, they're not looking too great offensively. Also, you know, we can talk about how the Chiefs lost to the Raiders last week, but the Bengals lost royally to the Pittsburgh Steelers last week, losing that game 34-11. So, I mean, we talk about a pretty big loss there as well. And we know the Chiefs, we like to think the Chiefs are a little bit better put together than the Steelers. And I think 7 points is not, you know, at home. All right. 7 points at home, one touchdown doesn't seem like an unreasonable spread to me. I think the Chiefs can get it done. Like Aaron said, I think they're going to come out and, show out here in the fourth quarter of the season, as you think, more like the 2 minute warning, that the Chiefs are a playoff team. And, I'm sure they're not happy about losing to the Raiders. And they're going to take it out on the Bengals.
Well, we better hope so. Dorothy, are you buying this or are you selling it? Chiefs or Raiders?
I am buying it. Yes, Abe and Aaron, I agree with what they're saying. Yes, they got to pick it up. I do think the Chiefs are too busy being famous stars. I'm not going to mention any names.
Javier Baez, his naked ass.
That's the joke.
Let's go Chiefs today.
Nuggies.
All right. Well, then that leaves Chab Dog and I on Bengal Island with
Nuggies.
With him. All right. On to game 7. Speaking of Pittsburgh, it's the 8-7 Steelers at the 8-7 Seahawks, 4:05 p.m. Eastern, 1:05 p.m. here on the West Coast for those of us who have DirecTV or have the Sunday ticket actually through YouTube now. Seattle's a 3.5-point home favorite, and a third straight win, because they've won two in a row here, would lock the Seahawks into the playoffs. A loss doesn't end their postseason chances, but it reduces it to 41%. So if Pittsburgh somehow wins today, their playoff chance increases to 23%. So they're pretty much on life support right now. I like the Seahawks at home here. I even with the extra half, the half-point hook, I'm not bothered by that. They're a better team right now. I mean, Mason Rudolph is doing amazing things, but I think they found a way to take him down. And I'm just not convinced. You know, traveling west in the afternoon, I don't know, just not feeling it here. Give me the Seahawks. But, Aaron, you're taking the Steelers. Why do you think Steelers can come out here and prevail?
It's Mason Rudolph. It's, I don't know. Mason, they're coming off, I don't want to overreact too much to this game they played against Cincinnati, where I did pick correctly the Steelers. That was an easy win for me. But I just like the Steelers as this underdog. They always fight for Mike Tomlin. Mike Tomlin is always going to make them a scrappy team. Not a huge believer in Seattle this year. They've been up and down, very mid, and they are coming off. They are on the upswing, coming off those two wins. They had that big upset to beat Philly. So, yeah, I'm not feeling great, but I like Seattle. I like Pittsburgh. I mean, Pittsburgh, road dog, lose by a field goal.
Yeah,
and you try to ride out this Mason Rudolph thing. Maybe the Mason Rudolph thing is an actual thing that is happening, and that Pittsburgh is going to all of a sudden score some more points. So, I'm not going to make some huge take on this. I like Pittsburgh. It's going to be close.
Dorothy, Who are you on here?
Yes, thank you for covering this game because this is one I haven't written yet. JP said Pittsburgh. My brain said Seahawks. My bookie is a Pittsburgh fan, so he refuses to give his answer. I'm going to go Pittsburgh.
So you're taking the Steelers. Wow. Well, Abe, that means you and I are the only people we're on Seahawk Island here together.
Why are
you taking the Hawks?
We're brother Hawks. Brother Hawks.
Bend over here. It comes again.
We're brother Hawks in this thing. You know, I don't like that Kenny Pickett is questionable. I think that might change a few things. Also, you know, before the Bengals, you know, the Steelers lost three straight. I mean, against the Patriots, against the Colts, against the Cardinals. You know, the Seahawks are coming off a two-game winning streak, beating out the Philadelphia Eagles, the Tennessee Titans. Teams that are, you know, a little bit better here than the Steelers, I think. At least the Eagles, anyways. I don't know. The Seattle and LA are 8-7 here in the NFC West standings. Seattle knows they have to win this game. You know, the Rams are going to win this, are looking to win their game. We picked the Rams, right?
That's right.
So now we've got Seattle who's like, hey, we got to win too. If we don't win this game and the Rams win their game, they're going to be right back there. They're going to be right behind San Francisco in the NFC West standings. So the Seahawks have a lot riding on this game. And they know that they want the Rams to lose and they need a win. And that's it.
All right. Let's hit the final game that we're going to talk about today, the Packers. So last night's game was the Monday night game. So, there's bowl games on the first, so there'll be no Monday night football game. So all we have is these games today plus tonight. We're going to see the Packers and the Vikings. Vikings, the 7-8 Packers at the 7-8 Vikings. So they got identical records. It's a battle for survival. The loser is dead. The survivor moves on. 8:20 p.m. tonight. Eastern, 5:20 here on the West Coast on NBC. Minnesota's a 2.5-point home favorite. And the Vikings are turning to rookie quarterback Jaren Hall. So this is their fourth fucking quarterback this year because they're largely out of options. Mullins threw 6 interceptions last week. Wasn't that funny? Oh, no, in 2 starts, actually. And Dobbs, he's just unable to move. He's in a hyperbolic chamber or something. So that killed him. It's a must-win game. I like seeing the battle, and it's a no-brainer for me. I mean, Jordan Love is better than anything they can put up there. I don't see how the Packers don't win this one. And yet, Chabdog's taking the Vikings, and Aaron's taking the Vikings. I don't understand. Aaron, explain to me how the Vikings have a shot here before I let Abe loose on you.
Packers aren't playing well. Lost to the Giants, lost to the Buccaneers, barely beat the Panthers by 3 points, and that game had a ridiculous comeback in it. But I have to believe that this Jaren Hall has been showing out in practice after he was lifted, or he got hurt quickly when he first came in, because he first came in for Cousins, and then he got hurt, and that's how Josh Dobbs got the start. And then Dobbs didn't play well, and then Mullins didn't play well. So Hall's back. Maybe Hall will reclaim the throne, show out a little bit. Yeah, it's just a hunch. The line doesn't make a lot of sense. I've liked the Vikings all season long, and the Vikings have been pretty good to me. So I will put my faith in them. And that's the Packers have had covering spreads the last 3 weeks. So line doesn't make sense. Just give me those Vikings.
All right, Abe, I'm going to release the Kraken on you.
We love winners.
Go get him, Abe.
All right, well, here's the thing.
Who is that?
You know, the Vikings are in a rotation.
Dorothy, who is that? Who is that man?
Who's that man who just kissed you, Dorothy?
Yeah. She looks shocked.
I think JP is shocked.
Yeah. Yeah, that was an unwanted advance there. We saw live on tape. We have this on camera. Yeah, please behave yourself.
Dorothy, some man kissed you.
You tell that fellow to behave himself there, Dorothy.
And it wasn't your boyfriend.
No. Yeah.
And JP looks not happy.
Oh.
JP punching that guy
bestie,
out right now.
This is bestie, okay?
Hmm? Oh, okay.
This is bestie. They both love me. Well, okay.
Well, let me tell you, besties turn on each other really fast when they start kissing their girlfriend.
And his bestie's dad really likes me, FYI. Bestie's dad, like, loves me. I don't know what it is.
Let's have sex.
Well, here's the thing on the Packers.
Okay,
this game is a must-win game for the Packers.
Yes,
if they want to increase their playoff odds, to make it in the playoffs, they have to beat Minnesota today. There's no. This is it. This is either you make it or you break it. You don't beat the Vikings, Mr. Love. You can just get your ass back on your bus to Wisconsin and not come out until next season, because this is it. It's all riding. You know, their playoff chances significantly rise if they can beat the Vikings here. The Vikings are a mess. They've got a horrible QB situation. Their QB situation is just as bad as my boys' New York Giants team over there. Although I actually like Tommy Cutlets. I thought he was fantastic.
But it is similar. You have the primary backup getting hurt and then coming back and leading the team to glory. So I agree. I think they are very similar situations.
They're a similar situation here. And unfortunately, the Vikings don't have Tommy Cutlets on their team. And it's just going to be a wild card. It's a wild card. You got something where you don't. I mean, it could go good for them, or it could go really bad for them. But you know, the Packers at least have the same quarterbacks playing today as game one of this season. So Jordan Love has already gone through this 16 times as we're in week 17. You know, plus the preseason a little bit. So he's already, he knows what he's coming into here. And I think, yes, you know, they haven't been, winning games, with dominance, the Green Bay Packers this season. But I think this is one of those matchups where I think they can win against the Vikings. And that's kind of proven by the fact that, the spread is the matter of fact, guess what? The Vikings are favored in this game by 2.5 points. So we're talking about a Packers team that's coming in here as underdogs that are better seasoned, that have played longer with each other, that it's a must-win situation, and the Packers can't stand the Vikings anyways. And they beat them,
Abe, so, it sounds like a big Christmas gift. Dorothy, who are you taking in this one?
This is another one. JP and I disagreed. I was taking Vikings. JP was Packers. I asked my bookie. He said Packers. And I do like the Packers better. I don't like the Vikings. So I'm on the Packer bandwagon. Cheeseheads for life. For my dad.
Okay. And the Vikings Commanders? Commanders and 49ers. I'm not going to pull that Viking thing again this week. Who's your pick there?
Niners. Okay. Niners.
Wow, this is the first week.
That's a big spread.
I think it's the first week all season. We only had one island. Said, one island.
A bookie.
Week, which is Aaron.
My bookie.
That's that. So we've got Chad Dog.
I go. My bookie
Aaron
will be there
Vikings.
Too. My bookie.
Abe, actually, the bestie's name is Buddy. My buddy. It's his name.
We should sing it for your bookie.
We sing that.
We should have a bookie theme song. Tell bookie to call into the show. We want to talk to your bookie.
I know. I should. I haven't seen him since 1999.
Who saw this?
There's Pop-Tart. We love Pop-Tart.
Did anybody see this? Watch the Pop-Tart Bowl with K-State.
We saw. Yes. I saw him come out of a massive toaster.
Unbelievable!
He came out of a toaster. Look at that.
I know. It's incredible.
That is so cute.
So Twitter or X is just totally alight with this Pop-Tart thing, and I'm just going to show you guys some of the stuff they did. Look at that. And so they lowered them into a toaster, and what else they do? Yeah, check that out.
I mean, Pop-Tart has to be a permanent mascot now, you know? Yeah, I mean, how can he not be?
It's so cute.
Is he going to come to the Super Bowl now? If not this year, next year? I mean,
this is just amazing.
Yeah. He's so truly cute. Look. My uncle and cousins work for Kellogg's.
Here he is. It looks like a
bowl. Look, Pop-Tart right won the bowl right game. Doesn't matter who wins, Pop-Tart wins.
You know, I saw one of these and showed this so picture cute. Here, and Pop-Tart's holding a sign saying, I have information on Hillary Clinton, and that shows us the bullet hole, a bullet entry on him.
Oh, jeez.
He shot himself with a revolver. Yes. He shot himself. He suicided. Oh, look at that. Now we got toys.
The other one was the Barstool Bowl in Arizona.
Well, I was about to get to that.
That one was good, but the Pop-Tart one was amazing. What a great one. They got to do that next year.
December 16th, you see that? We missed the Myrtle Beach Bowl, people. Ohio beat Georgia Southern. And the Cricket Celebration Bowl. R plus L carriers. I don't know what they're carrying. And I know what avocados are. From the Cure Bowl. Ooh, that's gross. They're avocados that need to be cured. They have disease or something. Is Telem New Mexico Bowl, LA Bowl. Oh, yeah, UCLA beat somebody. Okay. Texas Tech, the Radiance Technologies Independence Bowl in Shreveport. Of all the places you want to go, let's go to Shreveport, Louisiana for a vacation. Smell the refinery. I guess you can gamble there. Sure. Yeah, casinos, exactly. It's the depraved casino junkies go there. Texas Tech. Only steers.
Bueller.
Oh,
Bueller.
Look at
Bueller.
Here's on December 18th. Did anybody watch the famous Toastery Bowl? Ooh, in overtime, Western Kentucky. Yeah. Scooter's Coffee Frisco Bowl from Frisco, Texas. Marshall. Ugh. The roofclaim.com Boca Raton Bowl. My God. Union Home Mortgage Gasparilla Bowl. Birmingham Bowl. Camellia Bowl. Lockheed Martin Armed Forces Bowl. We love Lockheed Martin because it's one of our contractors we work with. Good people. I guess Air Force plays somebody there. Famous Idaho Potatoes Bowl, 68 good. Ventures. Not 69, but 68 ventures, whatever that is. And then the SRS Distribution Las Vegas Bowl, Easy Post Hawaii Bowl. Yeah. God, look at that. Okay, here we are. Here's the real stuff here. The Quick Lane Bowl from Ford Field in Detroit, Minnesota against Bowling Green. Oh, boy. Let's travel to Detroit on December 26th and watch Minnesota play Bowling Green, family. Let's go. Surf Pro First Responders Bowl from Gerald Ford Stadium in Dallas. I don't even know where that is. Guarantee Rate Bowl, Chase Field. Oh, yuck. The Duke's Mayo Bowl. That sounds...
Yes.
Oh. I do like a BLT, though. Here we go. The DirecTV Holiday Bowl. Yeah. USC, even with a backup quarterback, just smoked Louisville. Number 16, Louisville gets smoked by USC. Go, OJ, go.
Miller Tax Moss. Act, Miller Texas Moss was Bowl. Miller Boss.
Look at that. The Wasabi Fenway Bowl. Aaron, do you know what wasabi is?
Oh, someone told me. Now I forgot. It's not referring to the Japanese stuff, the green stuff you put on sushi. It is some it's tech not? Startup or something.
Oh, man. Here I was. I thought I knew what they were talking about. All right. The Bad Boy Mowers Pinstripe Bowl. I guess I could figure that. Hey, Rutgers. Woo! Rutgers won a bowl.
Big win for Rutgers.
And there's that Pop-Tart Bowl we were looking at cuts from a moment ago. And then the Valero Alamo Bowl. I remember the Alamo Bowl. Now it's sponsored by Valero, a gas company from somewhere in Mexico or something. Arizona and Oklahoma. Okay. And then we have the Tax Slayer Gator Bowl. Tax Slayer. Ugh. Tony the Tiger Sun Bowl. Oh, Notre Dame won. Okay, yay. Beat Oregon State. Notre Dame beat Oregon State. Boy, Notre Dame got relegated to the Tony the Tiger Sun Bowl. Notre Dame. Hey, boys, you get to play in the Tony the Tiger Sun Bowl. Have fun. Imagine you're told that at the beginning of the year. You get to play in the Tony the Tiger Sun Bowl.
The Sun Bowl, I think technically it's one of the oldest bowl games. It wasn't always called the Tony the Tiger Sun Bowl.
No.
I think it's weirdly one of the oldest games. And yeah, Notre Dame did a good job.
Well,
pretty sure DJ Uyunglele didn't play in it for Oregon State. But yeah, again, Notre Dame got a nice little win there.
The Gator Bowl, the Sun Bowl, and the Liberty Bowl are all bowls that I remember growing up with as a kid and all have much higher esteem today, and that they would never have attached Tax Slayer, Tony the Tiger, or AutoZone to any of those before. So they, you know, those are the sellouts we're looking at right there. And then we have the Trans Perfect. I don't even want to know what the Trans Perfect Music City Bowl is. That's fine. But then there's the Barstool Sports. So Wyoming had a whopping 1-point victory over Toledo. Oh, God, Abe. This is what we were waiting for? Huh? Bueller?
Bueller? Bueller? Bueller?
I hope Barstool has better luck next year. You know, and all 14 people watch that game. Or, you know, 16
well,
plus
you
15
know,
people
as,
watch the game.
As long as Frank the Tank's out there flipping the coin, I mean, that's about as good as it gets. You
oh,
know,
Tank
for
flipped
me.
The coin?
Yeah, he did.
Oh,
he,
oh yeah.
Well, shit, if Tank,
yeah,
that's
came
good for
30,000
people
right
there.
Last year went
right
to overtime.
There.
He got to flip it twice.
Yeah, okay. 30,000 people a show. Yeah, yeah, that's a 60,000. Okay, that's different if Frank flips the coin. That makes Wyoming.
Yeah, well,
I would watch Wyoming versus Toledo if I knew he was doing that.
Yeah, Edwin Diaz, Timmy Trumpet song too. That was. It's always it's so funny.
Yeah.
See him come on out there.
Well, I'm sure you can't wait to wake up tomorrow morning and watch the ReliaQuest Bowl, Wisconsin versus LSU, or the Cheez-It Citrus Bowl, Iowa versus Tennessee. Mm. We can sleep off our hangovers for those.
We have should have the Rose Bowl, no?
Yeah, it's at the top of the page here. Yeah, Rose Bowl.
Rose Bowl.
This is the one we want. 5 p.m. East, 5 p.m. So 3 p.m. out here.
You know, it's funny that they've never really changed the name of that. It's just the Rose Bowl.
Yeah, because the Rose Bowl won't.
Like, it's not, you know.
They refuse to sell it.
Shohei Ohtani Bowl.
Same with the Caesars Superdome.
Right.
They refuse to
sell
it. Yeah,
just give them, just wait. You just wait.
So
we still have the iconic classic name has not been, you know.
Yep. Those are
alluded.
Those are the two games I'm interested in watching.
I think they'll keep it that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Although I would be happy if Pop-Tart guy came out there, though.
Yeah.
I'd be okay with that.
The Pop-Tart Rose Bowl.
Well, if I can give my 2 cents
please
on Pop-Tarts, since I didn't
what
come
you got
prepared
Pop-Tart?
Today.
You shouldn't eat Pop-Tarts. Huh?
Go ahead, Dorothy.
My cousins work for Kellogg's and agreed it's not wholesome. But if your kids aren't going to eat anything else, it's a lot better than candy for breakfast. Because it is fortified and rich with nutrients, vitamin B's and stuff. So, of course, it's not as good as apple and peanut butter, natural. But some kids aren't going to eat that. So that's why we have these kind of foods, you know, kids that are picky. So
okay.
It's not horrible. It's better than
yeah, my kid loves Pop-Tarts. I get him to eat Eggo waffles in the morning. But other than that, like Pop-Tarts, those are the, and like any sugary cereal, those are the only things I'll eat for breakfast.
And Kellogg is out
and,
of Battle
you know,
Creek,
Michigan.
That's
why these companies make them.
Yeah, exactly. That's why it's their Pop-Tarts exist.
Dorothy, you've been to Battle Creek,
right,
Michigan?
Right, I hate that people are like, oh, they're the devil. What was that?
Have you been to Battle Creek, Michigan?
Oh, heck yes. That's where my mother was born.
Yes, that's the headquarters of Kellogg's is Battle Creek, Michigan. And Kellogg's was formed
yes,
because there were some rich people there. Oh, Kellogg's. He was getting grains from coming across the Great Lakes from he had a surplus of grains. And he had the ear of he had
mm-hmm.
enough money
yep.
to buy the advertisers on Madison Avenue in New York City and was able to get them to convince the nation that they should change their breakfast they should even be a meal called breakfast and to change it to consuming grains that he has a surplus of. And made cereals out of them for humans instead of livestock to get a higher value of them and paid Madison Avenue to advertise them to the masses. So there's a little piece of trivia there for you. Do you know that story, Aaron? There was a movie that, what's his name, was in, Ferris Bueller did all about that, about Kellogg's and stuff back in the 90s that everyone forgot about.
Does Does anybody know about the merger of the XFL and the USFL and what that's going to turn into?
Hey, I got to look into that. I got to look into that because my New Jersey Generals are looking to bounce back after just a terrible defeat in the playoffs last year. Well, yeah, I have to see what it's going to look like. I don't know if they have made any further announcements.
They said that UFL might be, maybe it's called the UFL? I'm not sure.
Nah, they got to call it something.
Well, we're going to have to figure all that out next year because it's 10 o'clock, everybody. It's time for football.
All right, guys.
So
we'll figure it out.
Are you ready for some football?
Enjoy your cruise, Dorothy. Enjoy your cruise.
I want to wish everybody a happy new year.
It's been great knowing you guys.
Exactly. Everyone out there, Dorothy and
another great year. Aaron
and look at that bird wave.
And all the five people who are watching us right now, I want to wish you all a happy new year. Thank you so much for watching. We're looking forward to bringing